All right. Praise you, Jesus. Lord, I just want to right now, Lord, thank you. Thank you, Jesus, for giving me opportunity, God, and the ability to do what you have me do in your kingdom for all these people, Lord. I praise you, and I really do thank you for giving me a chance to live, to do all this, Lord. I do praise you and thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Lord, y'all, have mercy. Have mercy. All right, I know I'm busy today. I know this is my third video, I know. And I've done talked with like a bunch of y'all already and everything else. And this is what we do. This is what we do. This is what I do. This is what God let me live to do. Amen. All right. And I know we're going to talk a little bit about the day of the Lord. But let's just go into 1 Thessalonians all together. This first epistle to the Thessalonians was written by the Apostle Paul to the church he had established in Thessalonica on his second missionary journey with Silas. Okay. Paul had preached there for only a few weeks when the Jewish leaders accused him of civil rebellion and reason for announcing that the true Lord and King of, you know, the King was Jesus and not Caesar. Right? Paul and Silas were forced to leave this infant church. Amen. Sorry, y'all. Stuff's popping up all over my phone here. And Satan hindered their plans for return, right? So Paul must have shared the gospel with every single breath. He imparted enough in a few weeks to turn people from idols and leave a healthy, faith-filled, you know, live a healthy, faith-filled life. You know, assured them of their salvation. Now, you can be assured of your salvation, y'all. Now, I know y'all, wait a minute. No. But that doesn't mean you can't forfeit it. If you give your life to Jesus Christ, listen to me. If you give your life to Jesus Christ, what did I say? Give your what? Give your life. Look at this word right here. Give my life to Jesus. Give my life. That means everything you are, everything you do, everything you say, think, feel. See, the old life you had, the minute you got saved, is dead. It's dead. It's gone. If you continue the same things you did, then it never died. You have a new life once you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And now you have to learn to live that new life. You have to now learn to be that new person that you just became. You gave your life to Jesus. Not just your words, not empty words, but your life. A lot of people give empty words, y'all. That's most people. There's a wide road of self-deceived people. But people that really give their life to Jesus, there's not that many. Okay? And that's what he let me live. To guide and direct you to that narrow road, okay? All right. So, since Paul couldn't return to Thessalonica, you know, he got forced out, he sent Timothy back to check on their progress, right? The church's progress. And when Paul found out they were thriving, he wrote to express his gratitude for their faithfulness, talking about the church. And he encouraged them to continue in sexual purity and responsible love and respect for leaders, right? And patience and care for one another. Okay, that's what he preached. You have sexual purity. Sexual sin is a big one Satan will tempt you with. Responsible love, respect for your leaders, your teachers, your preachers, your leaders, or wherever. And have patience and care for one another, which is the second greatest commandment. And apparently some believers in the church had died and started raising questions of what would become of them after they die, right? What happens to us when we die? You know, there's a question. And Paul brought a lot of great hope and comfort by revealing that upon the Lord's return, the dead in Christ would be resurrected first. Okay, now he's talking about your body. Because when you die, your spirit, who you are, your thoughts, your conscience, what you see, smell, hear, to all that goes, if you're a Christian, goes with God, straight to God. If you're not a Christian, it goes to the pit, okay? And waits for the judgment day, lake of fire, all right? But your body, this sinful, cursed body, because when Adam and Eve sinned, God's spirit went out of them. He was their life, their only source of life. He was. When they sinned, that spirit left their body, went out of them. They pushed it out. They shoved it out by sinning, and they chose it. Okay? But, so, Zerins, this is Adam and Eve, and I can't draw, and it's okay. Once they chose to sin, they shoved the Holy Spirit over here. He's still there, but right now, they're now, sin has taken over their being, and here's the Holy Spirit out here. Okay? So now, God had to give them a set of rules, because their heart got turned darkened once they sinned. The God's Spirit came out of them. They shoved them out, quenched them, okay? Put them out, all right? And now they got sin. They're covered in sin. So now they're like, oh, no, what happened to us? I don't feel the same. Nothing's the same. I'm not happy. I don't feel joy anymore. What happened here, right? Well, he's out here. That's why they're missing all that. So God said, you have to learn now to knock that darkness off your heart. And you do it by obeying my commands. You have to obey me to get that chiseled off of there, to chisel it and get it back to purity. That's the only way you're going to get any of that joy back, any of my spirit back, is to chisel that off. Now you choose that. Choose that. Okay? And that's where the rules came in, the commandments. Okay? Well, no, the original commandment was one commandment before that, not to eat off that specific tree. Okay, so that's the first one they broke. But now comes all these other rules, okay, that they have to abide by in order to chisel some of that stuff off their heart and get the spirit back in there. Because the spirit ain't, Holy Spirit won't go in there with all that willing sin going on. You chose it. Now you got to choose to get it out and let him come back in. But you see, he hasn't left. He's still around them. See how he's still around them? He said, I'll never leave you and I'll never forsake you, but I'm going to be right here waiting on you to repent and change your mind. Right here waiting on you. But you got to make your mind up and do it. You do. I'm not going to come in like a robot and force myself on you. No, you chose that sin. Now you choose to get my glory back. You choose. It's all your choice. And Satan knows the deal here. So he's going to throw up every single sin at you he can do. Anything he can think of, man, to keep you away from God. Anything he can do. And he's coming at you with arrows, pew, 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 constantly. Constantly. So if you don't abide, if you don't get to know God and abide in his word, obey the stuff he told you to do. He knows why he's telling you to obey these things y'all don't want to do. Because it will purify you and get your heart back right so he can come back in there and live in you. That's the only way, y'all, to accept him with your heart. And you do all that because you want him, because you love him, and you want him in you. Not standing on the outside. You want him in you. Because then you have power. You have no power with him standing on the outside waiting on you to repent and apologize and stuff, y'all. All you got to do, he's there all the time like this with his hand out. Reach out and grab him. We chose the sin. When we sin, we choose it. Okay? When we come out of this body, whether we go to heaven or hell, we choose it. Do you know how many people's in hell today? And what they're doing? There ain't no friends in hell. There ain't no buddy system in hell. Everybody, there's nothing but hate there. That's it. You could have been the closest relatives here on earth. You go to hell, you hate your enemies now. God's love is not there. There is no love there. At all. It's pure hate. And all regret. Everybody there is in total regret. Because they know they're there forever. They know that. And they're going to live with that forever. Okay. So anyway, these people in the church want to know what's going to happen to them when they die. So, he started out. I'm just going to fly through this. In chapter 1. He said it was 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm just going through. Yeah, there's not that many. Chapter 1. Let's start at verse 5. He says, "For our gospel did not come to you in word only, but in power also, and in the Holy Spirit, and in much assurance, as you know what kind of men we were among you for your sake." Okay, so he's talking about demonstrating God's power. And that's what we are to do. That's what being a Christian is about. It's us learning to know God's word. And if you're not obeying his word, y'all, you're not. You are not abiding in him. You're not learning God's word. You know, you ain't learn nothing if you're not abiding in his word. Okay? That's when you learn, when you do. Demonstrating God's power is the first what he's talking about here. Okay. Because God does not change. You understand? God, I the Lord God, do not change. I believe it's Malachi 3:9. I the Lord God do not change. Well, because God does not change, he wants to demonstrate his power in his church today, just as he did in the days of the apostles. Okay, and as people of faith, we need to pray. We need to be praying for that to happen. And we absolutely must not allow ourselves to be intimidated by our own, you know, humanness and fallibility. You know, I heard somebody in the comments section talking about how much you keep messing up. Well, you know what? We're going to mess up. It's when we willingly do it all the time. Willingly. Okay? But the minute you slip up, that's a slip up when it's an accident or oh man, I just made a bad choice right there. I didn't mean to do this. Your desire is to change. He'll help you change. And you might slip up a bunch. But he's right there to forgive you. He wants to forgive you. Don't condemn yourself for slipping up, y'all. Just get up and get back on track quickly. Instead, keep your eyes on Jesus Christ. You know, the source of our power and strength. That's him. He's the source. He is the source of your power and your strength. Jesus. That's not your own strength. You ain't got no strength. We fail, man. We're fallible people. When you go to Jesus and you submit yourself to him, he is your strength. Just like he's my strength right now, getting me through everything I've lost a year and a half ago, which was almost everything to me. He's your strength. And he's the one that stands ready to confirm his word through signs and wonders. And we are to step out in faith. When you obey God, what do you do? What is obey God? When you obey God, it means you honor him. You respect him. And you're stepping out in faith. Sometimes you have to step out in faith and trust God. Trust him. Give him a chance. You have to obey him in some things that you're going to have to trust him in. Step out of faith. That's what that means. If you're like, oh, I can't do that. Oh, I'm not doing that. You got no faith. Step out in faith and trust him. Okay? And then sometimes your walk's going to require you to step out in faith. And to obedience to what God has called us to do. If you don't obey him, he can't use you. He can't use you. God has chosen to work through human vessels, y'all. That's what he did. God chose to work through us even after Adam and Eve sinned. He's still wanting to work through us. And open the door for a great, what does it do? It opens a door for a great demonstration of his power. When you step out in faith, you think you can't trust him, and you go ahead and step out in faith and trust him, you get to see his power. And he loves to show his power. But Satan don't want you to see his power. Our Lord promised to appear again, y'all, and complete his work of salvation. It's not it, what his the listen. It's not over for us, okay? Every day you're on this earth, he did what he needed to do. It's finished for him. He did all he needed to do to open the door for me and you to have another chance. It's not over for us. We still got choice. We still can choose to him or reject him. He did everything he needed to do in order to get us back, but we got to choose him. And as we look forward to that time through the eyes of faith, we need to pray that our words of testimony be accompanied by the power of signs and wonders and miracles. Okay? Be a doer of God's word. You can't be a doer if you're not obeying God in everything. And in turn, when we hear the testimony of other people and the preaching of God's word, we are to receive it as coming from God himself. When you hear teachings and preachings coming out of my mouth, it is from God himself. It is coming directly from the throne room. There's no person on this planet teaching me nothing about God. That's the way he said for me it had to be. Because he told me my own people do not know my word. And they don't know how to hear me. Well, that's why he didn't let me walk into hell 17 years ago, y'all. That's why he put his hand on my shoulder and ordained me in person to do what you see me doing right now. It's all God's power. It's all Holy Spirit. So listen to this, because it is the Holy Spirit talking to you. And that will enable you to avoid negating the authority of God's word or blocking its effectiveness for growth in your life. Because when you stand around and you don't know God, how do I know if she's from God? Well, it tells me that you don't even know God when you ask stuff like that. Because he said, my sheep know my voice. When you know God and you know his word and you're living in obedience to him, you will know if what you hear is God or not. You'll know. So that means a whole bunch of y'all need to put their phones and the internets down, except for my video, and pause it. Go through all of them. Pause it and study with me. Study, because every single lesson comes directly from the throne room of what he wants you to learn. Pause the videos, y'all. Get your notebooks out. Don't just read the Bible. Study it. Dissect the scriptures. Write down everything it means to you. What's it mean to you? What's it telling you? Listen for the Holy Spirit to teach you. I want you to remember, as we hold forth the hope of our Lord's return, we offer encouragement to our brothers and sisters in Christ. That's what we do. And as well as a, we're also a light to those who still remain in darkness. That's what we are. And the gospel, the word of God, look at verse number 5, what I just read. For our gospel did not come to you in word only, but in power and in the Holy Spirit. The way in which the gospel was presented to the Thessalonians is a model for how the gospel should be communicated. Although the gospel was preached intelligently and sensitively, it was also communicated with power. Power comes from the Greek word dunamis, which is the origin for our word dynamite, dunamis, power. Jesus talked about the power that would come from the Holy Spirit. And that's all up in the book of Acts. Acts chapter 1, verse 8 I'm talking about right now. Paul and the other Christians were filled with the power of God. And when they preached, it was like an explosion of spiritual dynamite, which is what the Lord does through me. Why do you think he chose me to do this, y'all? I didn't know why in the world he would choose me to do this. I was one of the biggest sinners walking this planet. I stood in front of him. I had just committed suicide. Why do you think he chose me? Well, he obviously knew I was going to give my life to him, total surrender, 16 years from that date. And he knew that I was going to go to total surrender, which means his power, I'm allowing his power to just blow through me. Through my personality, through my mouth, I give it all to him, and he's using it. There would be an explosion of dynamite coming out of the Holy Spirit's mouth. That same dynamite, y'all, can fill us and explode through your life, too. In transforming your ministry today, it's dynamite. That's what the Spirit is, man, is power. When I looked in Jesus' eyes, when I stood in front of Jesus, he wasn't glowing. His robe wasn't shiny. It was white, but it wasn't shiny. His belt wasn't spectacular. We were in the desert, y'all. Why were we in the desert? Because what I just done, my life was barren. That empty barn, y'all, that's my duty to fill that barn up with you guys. Okay, but my barn was empty. And God, let me see it. Look at your barn, Kim. It's empty. Look at where you are, Kim. You're in the desert. You're about to step into outer darkness. But I'm going to give you another chance. So you want to know why I teach and preach with so much power? Because I know what he saved me from. And I know what I'm here to do. And I know God and his word. And I know why I'm on this planet. To teach it to you. And you know what he said? Some will listen, some will not. But just teach, Kim. Just teach. Teach my word. I want you to pause the video and read chapter 2, verses 3 through 12. Go ahead and do that. All right, you should have paused the video and read 1 Thessalonians 2, 3 through 12. It's talking about Christians are to be people who are transparent, open, honest, and accountable people. A Christian, that's a person who lives with the highest degree of integrity in personal relationships and in every area of your life. Living your life in disobedience is not integrity. A Christian does not hide who he is or try to cover up things and put on a religious show. That's what the Pharisees did, okay? A true Christian you're a member of a body of Christ, like right here. Some of you are part of my Google Meets, which is where we have our church. I have church with some of you right here every day on right here on my channel. Some of you, this is where you're coming and you're actually growing from. It's your church. Where you're getting fed is your church. And you got to be accountable to spiritual authority in that church. I've already taught you that, where you are to be under in submission to your teachers and preachers. Why? Because we're looking out for your soul. That's why. A Christian's life should always be an open book. Okay, that's what it's telling you. All right, you look at chapter 3. He's concerned about their faith, and he's getting encouraged by Timothy here, and he prays for the church. He talks about, look at verse 13, so that he may establish your hearts blameless in holiness. In what? Holiness before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all his saints. He's saying, Jesus is coming back. Are you going to be found holy or disobedient? How are you going to be found when Jesus suddenly comes back? Are you obeying God or are you disobeying God? How's he going to find you, y'all? Y'all, let's talk about that word holiness. Holiness. The world does not have holiness. Let's talk about it just real quick. Is he going to find you that way or in disobedient? Because somebody's house is bigger than yours. Holiness. The world doesn't have a clue about the real meaning of holiness. You understand? Unfortunately, many Christians don't understand what holiness is either. Most of them don't. And they falsely think it's something weird and rigid, right? Holiness is really about spiritual power and becoming a whole person in God's eyes. It's the process, the quality, and condition of a holy disposition and the quality of holiness in personal conduct. Everything you say, think, do. It's the dynamic and the life-changing principle, y'all, that separates the believer from the power-draining beliefs and activities of the world. Hagiosun, it sets us apart as people of God who contain the supernatural power. God pours that into our life by his Spirit. But because our lives have become pure and committed to God's ways of doing things, then we can live in that power and a blessing. It's a blessing to do so. We're to have holy and blameless hearts. If you're living in disobedience, you don't have that. Holiness and blame. Blameless. Blameless what? Hearts. Holiness and holy and blameless hearts. If you're in any kind of disobedience, you don't have it. The Holy Spirit of God has been sent into our hearts to clean us up and make us holy and pure again, like I told you with Adam and Eve. God does not want any darkness to be in our hearts, y'all. None. None. Not none. If we allow Him to, the Holy Spirit will enter every single room of our inner being, purifying us and making us blameless and holy. To be a real Christian means living under the Lordship of Jesus Christ. And that means a total and absolute surrender of our heart, our everything we do from the heart. If you live in disobedience to God and you know you are, you're in a dangerous position. Let's look at chapter 4, verse 1. Finally, then, brethren, we urge and exhort in the Lord Jesus that you should abound more and more, just as you received from us how you ought to walk and to please God. You are to walk and please God. Walk with, that means abide in. He says walk, abide, all that equals obey. Do you know how important it is that you obey God, y'all? Do you know how important it's? Well, your eternal destination depends on it. You want to be a successful Christian? You want to have a successful Christian life? We'll never, y'all, we will never be able to live a successful Christian life until we learn to live to please God. That's it. Rather than pleasing ourselves. You can't please God while you're out to please yourself. Godly believers, they seek, they want to, they look to honor God. They look for ways to honor and obey God. They don't try to wiggle their way out of it. They want to. It's a very narrow road, y'all. Not that many people on it. And you would want to reflect God in everything you say, think, and do. That's a real Christian. Narrow road. Not that many. And this is not only while you're in church, but when you're home, when you're at work, when you're at school, anywhere. This successful Christian life consists of work that flows from faith. Write that down. Work, R-W-R-K, that flows from faith. Number two, labor, that flows from love, because you do it from your heart. And number three, patient endurance, that is born of living hope. God, you know, as you grow in God, y'all, He'll work these characteristics into your life if you faithfully ask Him to do so. Faithfully asking Him to do anything, that means you're obeying Him while you're trusting Him at the same time. That successful Christian life is also characterized by absorption and doing good for other people. You want to do good for other people. You know, the Holy Spirit changes your heart, y'all. That's what He does. You want this stuff. You don't want to try to find a way to get out of it. You want to do it. And one way we do this is to intercede for other believers and other churches in prayer. Help the church. Help God. This successful Christian life is a quiet, peaceful life, y'all. And we must never, ever, ever become involved in gossip. Things like that, that the church is full of, and we should always seek to be diligent in whatever work we have chosen to do. And we should conduct our lives, y'all, in such a way as to remain alert and self-controlled at all times. And as we follow these guidelines right here, we will earn a good reputation with unbelievers. You can't earn nothing with God, but we're out to try to get these unbelievers changed. Well, you'll earn a good spot with the unbelievers if you're real with God. There ain't nothing worse than an unbeliever talking about what a fake Christian you are. No, show them realness, y'all. And finally, the successful Christian life is centered on the knowledge and the practice of the commands of Scripture. What I say? The knowledge, knowing the commands, and the practice, doing them, obeying God's commands. If you don't do that, you're not a Christian. I'm telling you. God will tell you. He already told you. He said, if you love me, you will obey me, y'all. There you go. We are to model those commands in such a way that will draw others to the truth and the joy that can only be found in serving Christ Jesus. Okay, Jesus is coming back sooner now than he ever has. Okay, look at verse 17, chapter 4. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Don't you want that? Caught up, snatched away, to seize, catch up, take by force. That's what he said. We're going to be caught up, sudden force, out. Paul described what is called, what we call the rapture. The catching up, catching away. The exact word rapture doesn't even appear in Scripture, okay? It was formed from a word in Latin translation of the Bible, which for this phrase, it reads, I can't read the word, Simul Rapture Comelis. The rapture is when the Lord will come and take away his church from this earth. Catching up. Those who died in Jesus Christ will rise first. Their spirit will come right down. I guess they'll float around in the air. I don't know. Yes, they'll meet in the air. So they'll float around the air. Your body's going to come up out of that grave and meet your spirit in the air. You're going to come one and get a brand new instant glorified body that can never die, that can never get sick, can never feel pain, never feel sadness. Can never cry. And then the rest of the believers who are alive at that time will follow. Okay, Jesus Christ is coming back, you guys. And what he told me when I was with him, that you have to have your armor on. You have to be ready for his coming. You have to be ready. You have to live life right now. If you got time to be alive on this earth and you're here, he let you be here. He's giving you time to be holy and blameless. In other words, give your life to him. Honor, respect, step out in faith. Trust God with things you think you can't do that he told you to do. It'll save your life, y'all. It will save your life. Don't let anything Satan has here, y'all, keep you bound and taking you to hell with him, because that's his ultimate goal. That is his goal. Don't let him do it to you. Praise God. Don't let him do it to you, y'all. All right. I might do another video later. I got a lot to do. We got class tomorrow night, not tonight. So I know, because God is teaching. He got a lot to say to y'all today. What else you going to watch on here? Just come and watch. I'll put another one out later. I'm going to finish this. I'm already 33 minutes into it. It's long enough. I'm going to do another part. We're going to go through some other things, okay, about the armor and whatever God tells me to tell you. All right, dear Jesus, I pray over these people right now. God, I plead your blood over every single one of these people, God, that Satan is trying to harden their hearts. God, that me and you, God, through your word, the Holy Spirit will come in and chisel, that can reach their ears, God, that they'll listen, and you come in and chisel that darkness off their heart, God, because they let you. Because they want you to, God, chisel that disobeying spirit off of their heart, God, so they can be found blameless and holy when you appear in the sky or when they die. They'll be found blameless and holy, Jesus, when they stand in front of you, worthy of coming into your kingdom, worthy and doing a good job on this earth, God, of living your life, letting you live through their bodies, God. Satan has got so many of your people, God, trying to snatch them on that wide road through disobeying you, God. I plead the blood of Jesus on these people. In the name of Jesus, God, open their eyes, Lord. Open their eyes, open their hearts. Satan, I come against you, you foul spirit. In the name of Jesus Christ, and I cast you back to the pit where you come from. In the name of Jesus Christ, you spirits out there trying to get God's people to dishonor and disrespect and disobey God, I cast you to the lowest parts of the pit in the name of Jesus Christ and away from God's people. You have no power here. Be gone in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, touch these people, Lord. Open their eyes, God. Open their hearts, Lord. I know you said some will listen, some will not. God, open their ears, Lord, before it's too late. Open their ears, Lord, before it's too late. Thank you, Jesus. I plead your blood right here, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Let's get as many as we can, God, before you come, God. Let's go get these people, Lord. Let's do some road construction and widen that narrow road, God, that there's not that many people really on it, God. Thank you, Jesus. And thank you, God, for saving me and choosing me to help motivate these people to loving you. You said, if you love me, you will have no problems obeying me in anything. And you'll step out of faith and you'll trust him. Jesus, I pray that over these people, every single one of these people, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. God bless you. I'll be back in a little while. Anything you need is in the description or on JesusDoers.com. God bless you all.